Thank you, Dr. Mishra. It's always been a matter of privilege and pride for Sybil to be associated with IIBF, and we would hope to do so in future as well. So every other day when we open the newspaper, someone or the other is raising finger on banks and blaming them on NPA as if, you know, Indian banks is the only, and their corporate loans are the only spot of bother where the rest of the world is perfectly fine. And that's the impression we'd get, that what are the bankers doing. But, you know, there is one thing that sometimes we saw newspapers and media is so sort of engrossed in sensationalizing things that they do not give good news. So let me create a situation or, you know, tell you something that from 2011 to 2016, of course, if I look at the average consumer price inflation, it has remained very high. It has reduced in the recent times, but it has remained high. For 5 years in a row, it was quite high. If I look at CMI's database of top 2000 corporates and see their average wage hike, it has not kept with consumer price inflation. So there has been stress on the household balance sheet. Household liabilities has grown and savings has fallen. We see banks often short of raise the issue that deposits are not keeping pace. Corporates, obviously, we know they are the huge issue. Now, if this has been the situation, how has the retail loans performed? We don't hear anyone talking too much in various pink pages and various channels on what happened to the retail loans. So between in this last 5-6 years, retail loans has been one of the sectors which has grown very handsomely. Depending on banks to banks, various subcategories, it has grown from 10% to upwards of 20% for 5 years in a row. What has been the default rate? On an average, the default rate has been well below 3%. Has there been a spike in default rate in last 5-6 years, despite whatever is happening? No. So this actually, the credit should go to all of us in the banking and credit fraternity. And, you know, Sybil, of course, is the oldest bureau, but I will not sort of be parochial about it. But it has been a wonderful partnership that has been built up by banks, their technology teams, the bureaus, to see that the asset book on retail has grown and there has been no significant damage. So there's a, as they say, proof of the pudding. There is a proof right now where things have been not going great with the state of the world, but there has, and a retail banking portfolio is not a small portfolio. For some of the banks, if so, as of today, the current overall banking sector loan as per RBI's would be 73 lakh thousand crores. In Sybil, we have recorded 72 lakh thousand crores, just 1 lakh thousand crore, you know, there's a lag we will get. So of that, close to 20 lakh thousand crores is roughly retail in various shapes and forms. That has been doing fantastically well. It has been the other 50 lakh crores that has been the issue. Now, if one takes a look at, and you know, I would not like to, but all of you would know from your banks what you expect, how big you expect your corporate loan book to grow in next 2-3 years. I'm not asking of a show of hands or a numbers, but it's unlikely to sort of resolve your NPA crisis. NPA can get reduced if the recovery improves or if the denominator, the asset book, grows. So I will not be surprised if your senior leaders tell you that one of the key reasons why my NPA ratio can fall is if you grow my denominator, the asset base, and there's a significant part that retail and MSME loan can play. And that's because there's a track record of good performance, and there is still a lot of scope. If you look at household balance sheet in terms of leverage, as per Sybil data, we see that it's way below 2007-2008. 2007-2008, there was a mini scare in the retail where, you know, there was small ticket. But that was obviously a starting phase, and things, we don't see that level of household leverage right now, which means two things. Individual households which have a loan, they have the capacity to service more loan. So there's a scope, obviously, if they need it. Second is, of course, the uncharted territories, the unbanked unbanked population where, you know, a great start has been made by bringing them in the banking framework by Jan Dhan system, and that's left to the banking community and the risk management community to see how we can tap that to grow the books of the bank successfully without distorting the NPA. And that's, there's a lot of hope emerges from the fact, as Mr. Vijay has also mentioned, and it's a common fact, that MFI per se doesn't have a high default rate. Obviously, they have a different risk. They are subject to environmental risk. So we have seen small bits of portfolio. Say, I recall from my previous job around in Fitch that there was a MFI in Vizag, and it had a historical default rate of 50 basis point. Roughly everything got recovered. Then 2009, it shot up to 30% in a 3-month period. Why? Because they were tailors, fruit sellers, tea stall owners who depended heavily on the Vizag port. If global, due to global problems, Vizag port has lesser traffic, these guys will not be able to service the loan. So it is not that they cannot, or that the tea seller is actually, or the fruit seller is actually rushing away to his London mansion not to pay the 5,000 rupees to the bank. They cannot. So the risks are different, but there's a lot of scope. So where does credit rating of the individual comes in? Essentially, the problem and the theme is analytics. The problem of lending is one of information asymmetry. Say, if actually Bijan Daruwala is very good, you would get Bijan Daruwala interview your customers and he would say that in next 5 years he's not going to default. That's like perfect information. But unfortunately, most of us may not have skills like Bijan Daruwala, so we have to look for models, etc. So the problem of risk is essentially one of information asymmetry. So there are two parts, information and then there's an asymmetry part. What does information mean? I'll try to be pedantic at the point of being painful, but data, what we call as data, they are like commodities. They are like dots in a chart paper. Per se, one dot doesn't mean anything. When you connect the dots and see a trend, that is called information. In colloquial terms, you often mix up data and information together, but the first step of connecting the dots has been to gather the dots in a timely fashion, correctly capture the dots, and if the dots are large number of dots, then you have big data system and you have to connect the dots. After connecting the dots, say you have 4 dots. You can connect them with a straight line. You can do something what statisticians call best fit, which is approximately seeing that it's roughly follows through, touches around or comes close to. And based on that, you extend the dot, try to predict where the 5th dot will come. That is predictive. So analysis, what we call as business analysis, has 3 parts. Descriptive, predictive, and prescriptive. What is descriptive? I look at my current database and see what all are the problems, which are the segments which are growing, which are the regions which are growing, where there are default rate, profile the customers, and that's a very, very important part. Most of the things that's the starting part of all analysis. Know your own customers. Know how they behave. That knowledge also, there is an issue, because often, and statisticians make this error, they try to draw lines, which in statistical is called correlation, and say correlation is equal to causation. Often we do not know the cause and we do not have the time. So when today I'm close to 100 kilos and Reliance stock price is 900. If you had taken my weight in 1990 when Reliance stock price was 50 and my weight was 30 kilos, if you do a regression, the R square will say that Deep's weight has a 80% correlation with Reliance stock price. High correlation, there is no, so track Deep's weight next month and you will get RIL stock price. And that's often what happens. There is an excellent book I would refer some of you read it. It's on abuses of big data. It's called The Signal and the Noise. Do I confuse unless I know? So it's not that, I have this 25-year-old big data scientist and I will throw everyone above 45 years out of my office because they do not know big data. That will be a great mistake. Because then these guys who will be data scientists, they will know a lot on the tools, a lot on the machines, but they will not know the business reality. There's a huge communication angle that is required, that people to show, do you have been in banking for 25 years, does this make sense to you? How often do we have those communications? So, descriptive part, we should know how my customer, and that should be, should not be noise. You should get the correct signal. Next is predictive, that where will the next four, I have connected four dots, connected the line, fifth dot where it is coming, that's predictive. That predictive can be what we call model. It can be a probability of default model. It can be a probability of attrition model. We don't see a lot of that in India, but who are my customers? Who would be attriting because, say for instance, the model Manjit's team is building may be targeted at Mr. Ghosh's team's customers. So this is something which in econometrics is called statistical arbitrage. Statistical arbitrage is if you have a good set of customers, you have to build attrition models, which is actually de facto predicting which of those customers will be targeted by someone else. The name is statistical arbitrage. So you predict probability of default, probability of attrition, probability of, we do not look at something called share of wallet. Say for instance, since both of you gentlemen say I have an ICICI card and Yes Bank card and a SBI card, is SBI tracking, is Mr. Ghosh and Vijay tracking, am I shifting my spend to ICICI? It has been say 33 between three banks, and have I spent more with Rajat's bank? If I've been spending, that itself is a news, and someone should approach me that Deep, take this PVR ticket and, you know, please spend more. So prediction, predictive part. Next is, here it's a dots are data, connecting the lines are information, and the last is knowledge. You predict every time, the learning process begins, and someone has connected it by straight line, and then you figure it out, no, it's not working. I have predicted the fifth dot should come somewhere here because I was drawing the line, but the fifth dot came here, which means it's not actually a linear relationship, it's a sinusoidal relationship. You keep on learning. This is, by the way, not knowledge. This is again curve fitting exercise. Knowledge is explaining why it is not a straight line, why it is a sinusoidal line. Otherwise, when we interact with banks or in bank current, we often see banks models sometimes with strange variables which no one explains. And that is analytical harakiri. In a big data system, if you actually, because no machine will ever be smarter than a human being. They will connect and build those correlations. Now you do not know. So way back in early 2000, there was this analysis that was done by US Insurance, and it was, I'm not naming, it was like one of the best consultancy houses, gathered the best in class data, and they did this analysis that for insurance industry, and there's a case study in Harvard Business School for this, that most of the accidents happen within 10 miles of your house. Most of the driving accidents happen within 10 miles of your house. So there was an insurance company which is owned by one of the best investors in the world. A lot of Indians put garlands in his, for a lot of Indians. That gentleman owned this firm, and they went berserk on encouraging people to drive longer. Nothing happened. After 2 years, they found out, no, it's a basic problem of conditional statistics, Bayesian probability. Why 90% of the times accident happened within 10 miles of radius? Because 90% of the time you remain within 10%. So it was actually, and I'm not naming absolutely anyone, but if the best consultancy house in the world arguably and advising to the best insurance company owned by arguably world's best investor, if they make this and it takes 2 years to figure it out, I know for a fact I'm not even half that smart. So whatever I lack in my smartness, I'll make it up with caution and talking to people who have been in the system. Sir, ye aapko kuch samajh mein aa raha hai kya? Ye kyun hai? इफ आई गो टू फाइव पीपल हु हैज बीन इन बैंकिंग फॉर 10, 15, 20 ईयर्स और उसको समझ में नहीं आ रहा है ना, आई नीड टू लुक बैक एट द डेटा. बिग डेटा सिस्टम इज साइंस. सो दैट इज ऑलवेज द मैनेजमेंट व्हेन दे डेवलप बिग डेटा सिस्टम दे शुड बी वेरी कॉशियस. इट इज रिक्वायर्ड. इज इट रिक्वायर्ड? देर इज नो क्वेश्चन. इट हैज टू बी रिक्वायर्ड बिकॉज इफ यू हैव टू मीट आवर एस्पिरेशंस दैट्स द ओनली वे. बट ऑफन वॉट हैपन्स इज, सर मैंने ये मॉडल बना दिया, ये आ गया, ये इसको कहाँ लगाऊं? सो दे आर द सेइंग गोज फॉर समवन विद अ हैमर एवरी प्रॉब्लम लुक्स लाइक अ नेल. यू हैव अ सॉल्यूशन एंड यू हंट अराउंड, सर किस प्रॉब्लम में? यू हैव अ की एंड यू फाइंड आउट विच लॉक इट विल ओपन. सो बिफोर यू डिजाइन योर एनालिटिक्स सेटअप, फर्स्ट विल कम द बिजनेस प्रॉब्लम. व्हाट बिजनेस प्रॉब्लम आर यू सॉल्विंग? द सॉल्यूशन ऑफ ऑल बिजनेस प्रॉब्लम इज एक्चुअली नॉट एनालिटिक्स बाय द वे. से फॉर इंस्टेंस इन लार्ज प्राइवेट सेक्टर बैंक्स एंड पब्लिक सेक्टर बैंक्स वी हैव दिस थिंग कॉल्ड ट्रिगर, वेयर इफ यू हैव योर एग्जिस्टिंग सेट ऑफ कस्टमर्स, इफ समवन इज अप्रोचिंग देम यू सेंड अ ट्रिगर. सो वी सॉ सम बैंक्स आर फैंटास्टिक यूजर्स ऑफ दोस ट्रिगर्स. इफ द ट्रिगर हिट्स देम दे विल इमीडिएटली रीच आउट टू द कस्टमर एंड दे विल प्रिवेंट द अट्रिशन. अदर बैंक्स दे डू नॉट. सो वी फिगर आउट व्हाई. ऑब्वियसली द ट्रिगर गोज टू द ब्रांच मैनेजर एंड यू आस्क हिम, सर आप ये ट्रिगर, अरे इतना काम है, आपका ईमेल मैं खोलता ही नहीं हूं, इसमें कुछ आया था क्या? सो आई हैव बिल्ड अ फैंटास्टिक ट्रिगर एंड थैंक गॉड दैट वी नाउ हैव द टर्म बिग डेटा. नहीं तो पहले 8 साल पहले लोगों को बोलने में बहुत प्रॉब्लम होता था कि हम लोग काम क्या करते हैं. अभी बोलते वी डू बिग डेटा एनालिसिस. नहीं होता तो बोलते बहुत बड़े डेटा बेस में. And you know, it's how big and how fast we have to act as a bureau. So one of the banks which is not here, we have developed this and this is out in the open now. We have developed this world's fastest biometric and first biometric solution. So this bank we had for 12 months and it's going a national rollout. And we can share this because if you go to PVR, the ads of this product come. Of course, Sybil's name doesn't show. But you go to for 30 car distributors in the Bombay to Pune belt. We have given this small device. You go to buy a car, and if you are interested in a loan, you know, other banks would obviously say that I will come and give you a loan in 2 day, 3 day, or the helpful customer executive will say, main aapka naam likh leta hu, aapko kuch karna nahi hoga. All you have to do is give a thumb imprint. The thumb imprint would immediately go to Aadhaar database of 100 million, 100 crore Indians. Indians in Aadhaar, identify the guy based on thumb imprint, autofill the loan sanction at the back end, pull up the bureau, hit the bank's underwriting system, get a go, no go, activate the bank's loan disbursement system, and civil bureau as of last has 550 million records. Of 220 million customers. And that's just core credit, which is retail bureau. We have also launched an MFI bureau. It's 600 million rows. And the loan gets disbursed. And while you drive out with the car, the loan has already hit the distributor. Now you have to actually do a sign. So a thumb imprint and a sign. How long did it take? We promise. We think we are better than Domino's. We say it shouldn't take more than 30 minutes. The average process takes searching through 550 million records in bureau data, 100 crore Indians Aadhaar database mapping, that whole thing takes less than 30 minutes. By the way, in this process, we also do fraud verification. So frauds in Aadhaar are also slightly cropping up. But we also do fraud verification. So analytics has always to be grounded. This is why I describe this, because this is the prescriptive part. Once I know that this is the probability of default, this is the probability of attrition, what do I do? That comes prescriptive analytics, which is not in the realms of econometric statistics. It is more in the realms of operations research. What is the optimal product that I can give? Obviously, some people do but what is the optimal product? That is more a OR, lean programming problem. Where it will add to my share of wallet or to my NPV? So these are the three characteristics: credit, One thing we have done, I think our parent TransUnion, and there is a lot of paper on IEEE, which is world's premier presentation on electronics and machine learning. There is a fundamental difference between a risk model and a marketing response model. You cannot have a risk model, say I have given someone a home loan and today the default rate is 5%, a new data comes, it becomes 2%, because you keep capital. So you need to extract the signal from the noise. If you tell your finance CFO's office that you keep capital and I am building an excellent sensitive model which to this month will be 5%, next month 2%, he will be furious at you, he will not be sad. So the point obviously is risk model, the tools that you use for risk models has to be different from the tools that you use for customer management, customer satisfaction model. Customer satisfaction model, you give him a EMI, a pre-approved EMI, for you see him discussing on Facebook that he's planning a trip to wherever and you give him offer, that's one. You need to act to that person's sentiment. But risk model, the databases should not only be different, because you don't want noise, but the tools and techniques should also be different. Say for instance, you cannot, we have, and why we can tell, because we have all those random forests, ensemble modeling technology, etc., all in-house, and we have been working on it for 2-3 years. Two things, two problems. And this is not a new problem. Why historically neural networks has never been used for risk models in a large scale? Because every model needs to be governed, it needs to be explained to the regulator, needs to be audited. Neural networks or pure big data based model, which is like random forest, the descriptiveness is very limited. It is a statistical delight that I have got 1,000 variables and out of those 1,000 variables I have extracted principal components and I have used those principal components which has a variable balanced to the power 7/3 and it is giving a wonderful lift. It doesn't. A model, often people, you know, in economics and finance, and this test became popular after 2008, but this was always there. This is called the grandmother test of theory. You build the best model in the world, you go and explain to your grandmother who has seen the world, if she is not able to appreciate or understand, and you are not able to explain it to him in plain Hindi, Bengali, Tamil, whatever, if you are not able to explain as the model builder, either there is a problem in your model with you. It is, if you are not able to explain why that principal component has a balance to the power 7/3, or exp to the power, e to the power last period of default, if you are not able to explain, the explanation cannot be data dikha raha hai. Because big data, artificial intelligence is, intelligence is just an over term. It's not an intelligent system, it is just drawing patterns. So you use artificial intelligence and you will suggest that don't travel only outside 10 miles of your house to reduce insurance claims. So the methodology has to be, so big data, Facebook, etc., they can be used very differently. If someone has not paid you, how you hunt down that guy through Facebook. But through everyday Facebook Twitter, should I change my model? Yes, there are different sort of, so for instance, we are particularly aware that a lot of times what is identified, and we are undergoing research and we'll publish a white paper, I think maybe in 3-4 months after it goes through various regulators. But the initial finding is a lot of the times what we identify as credit loss is actually a quasi-fraud loss even in the retail space. And there is no way anyone can say that you can differentiate. What are the characteristics of this credit losses which are actually we think are fraud losses? There would be people who you have given a credit card 5-6 years back and they have ramped up the credit card in 3-4 months, and after that we see zero recovery from them and no further activity on their credit also. Because a bona fide guy can also default, and what you will see is we will find a suit filed, etc., etc. The guy will actually write to CIBIL that, the bank has charged me penalty. So that looks like it's a bona fide legal issue which can be discussed at the Lok Adalat level, etc. But these are very sleek and slimy people. 5 years, no trace. Then you see them coming up with a fresh application. The current popular application checking systems, they will not be able to trace, since they do not do verification at source. They will not be able to check that it is actually the same guy with synthetic identity. So the systems that we use actually tells that this is actually this one guy. He has taken name from someone, PAN card from someone, address from someone, phone number from someone, and created a synthetic identity. So these are also part of credit, because you know why I'm not discussing too many credit models, because I think all your in-house teams would be like, you know, there's nothing we can tell, ke sir, logistic regression bana lijiye, isko score kiye. There's no nothing, you know, there'll be no revelations as such. But what we are currently working on credit, and you know that's the focus you guys should also have. Look at those credit losses in the past, which are quasi fraud. If you are able to identify fraud and reasonable job of credit, because I think the market has good in India. I mean, in most of the major banks, they have, I think, appreciable ability to build pure credit risk models. I don't think there is, but what we need to do is to marry credit and fraud, build them at application systems, so that, you know, those 99 guys who are actually neither credit risk or fraud risk, you can able to solve their credit problems in half an hour. And that too, it should be new to credit, because your existing guy is based out of Bombay, have a credit card loan successfully closed, home loan successfully closed. They should not take too much of your time. They should be automated. There should be loan on the tap for these people. But the challenge is how to sort of grow out of tier 1, tier 2 cities, or even within tier 1 cities, the blind spot. There are a lot of people in the city who are below the radar, in the sense no one approaches them for credit. What system can I build for them? Because fingerprints for a lot of them will not work. Because they are manual workers, their fingerprints change, or it will not sort of get captured. I mean, how many times in your office when you have a thumb imprint, how many times you will sure enjoy one fine day that it is rejecting? So we are developing systems, and I think UIDAI is taking a fantastic lead. They are on iris scan. Can we do something? Can we use artificial intelligence, not for modeling, but can I do artificial intelligence that you send your representative to the person's house and they do a selfie together, and you ping it back to your system, and you use a AI software for photo recognition? So what you use that AI for, that is also critical. AI is a very, very powerful tool. Say if I am a salesperson in credit, I go to a slum, take a photograph in front of the door, and I shoot it back to the head office. In head office, there is an artificial intelligence software which will tag the photo and see that these two guys are same or not. That's a fantastic usage. So identify the tools and make the best usage of it. Caveat, while identifying best of the tools, don't neglect the inherent human knowledge within the your existing organization. There I would like to end with something that's called Occam's razor. Occam was something like a priest in 15th century. He was more of a philosopher. He was priest by accident. So Occam's philosophy, and why Occam is so popular, and Occam has made a revival after with revival of neural networks and AI basis. Occam said, make things simple. Keep it to the simplest possible element, but no simpler. So try to reduce your model explainability of the model to the simplest way. But yes, some models will be complex. Say for instance, the photo identifier AI, which will identify whether this person 10 years back photo is today's photo, that is a complex algorithm. You know, you cannot explain it to anyone. But for something that is in day-to-day life, can I explain it across the table to someone? Is making sense? So that sensitivity is to be there. Tools, I think most of the Indian banks, they had a fabulous experience in retail, and things are, we don't see too much stress over there. They are making excellent investments in systems, people. So doesn't look like, at least, I mean, it's difficult to predict for 5-10 years, but in next 2-3 years, doesn't look like there should be any hiccups. Things should continue to be at least on the retail space and MSME space where they are. Thank you. Thanks. Thanks a lot.